Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining the webinar today. My name is Shelley Wilkinson. I'm the Director of Sales here at TRICOM. TRICOM is pleased to introduce our Industry Insider Webinar Series. The purpose of the series is to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. Our presenters today are Mary Jo Heim, Director of Accounting, and Mike Ochter, Accountant at TRICOM Funding. Mary Jo came to TRICOM in 1996 and was promoted to Controller in 1998. Mary Jo is a certified public accountant and a certified payroll professional. She is also a member of the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants and the Wisconsin Institute of Certified Public Accountants. Mary Jo and her team of four certified accountants have nearly a half century of combined staffing industry accounting experience, and her clients rely upon her accounting knowledge and expertise for financial preparation and guidance. Mike has been a member of the TRICOM funding team since 1999 and holds a bachelor's degree in accounting from Marquette University. Mike gained over 12 years of staffing industry knowledge and expertise, which he applies directly to the compilation and analysis of clients' financial statements. He enjoys walking his clients through the financial statement process in order to help them get a better understanding of their business and methods that allow them greater control of their costs. Today's Industry Insider year-end webinar is an informative session designed to assist any staffing company owner or manager in preparing for the year-end. As we wrap up 2012 and ring in the new year, we'll review the items and critical changes essential to your staffing firm. We've collected and analyzed the information and will help you walk through our year-end activity checklist. By the end of the session, you'll have all the information you need to take the frenzy out of the year-end and face the new year with confidence. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the chat feature located on the right toolbar and submit questions to all panelists. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to give us your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. And with that, I'm going to turn the floor over to Mary Jo. There you go.
Good afternoon. Today, we're going to try and alleviate some of your year-end anxiety by going through some of the year-end topics and get a little clarity on some of the year-end items that are available. Our presentation today is going to be broken up into three parts. We have the reminders, which are administrative items that you need to be done before the end of each year. We have updates, and we're going to talk a little bit about what's new for 2013. W-4s. The reminder in relationship to W-4s relates to your exempt employees. They're employees that for one reason or another, have not had a tax liability for the current year, so in 2012, so they've requested to be exempt from withholding for federal or state. Each year, that exemption is ended at the end of the year, so a new form W-4 will need to be filled out by February 18th, 2013, in order for them to be exempt for 2013. Earned income credit. A few years ago, they took out the advanced earned income credit on W-4s, but the regular earned income credit is still available. For California, since 2008, employers are required to give additional notices to their employees besides what's on the back of a W-2, kind of explaining what information is necessary in order to be qualified for earned income credit. California has a specific notice that is available that you need to be giving to your employees every year. TRICOM employees have received, if you're in California, you've received a copy of this notice that you can give to your employees. It's an explanation that tells them at what wage basis their EIC becomes valid and how they can receive the credit on their tax return. There are five other states that require additional notice of EIC to employees. Illinois, Louisiana, and Texas allow you to use the federal form notice 797 as a valid notice to these employees. New Jersey and Virginia require you to have their specific state form. On TRICOM's website under resources, we have the new IRS notice 797 available to you for 2012, so that's the notice you can use if you're in Illinois, Louisiana, or Texas. We also have the new, as of yesterday, we have the new New Jersey notice, which was available also on our website. Right now, the Virginia notice is not available, but as soon as it's available, we'll have it on our website for anybody to download the PDF and give that information to their employees. A little bit about fraud protection. Those of you who are processing with TRICOM have really good fraud protection in place. Besides that, our checks have all the watermarks and other items necessary for fraud. TRICOM's payroll accounts are on positive pay. What positive pay is each day we send a file to the bank with a check register that says the check number, the employee name, and the amount. And those are matched each time a check is presented. So if any fraud would be attempted on our account, those are sent back as an exception, and we simply state them as fraud. Now, if fraud happens on your account and you're processing with TRICOM with your name on the check, we'll definitely be notifying you. How this basically works is you'll be notified by our accounting staff.
We're just having some technical difficulties, so sorry about that. We're getting the screen back up here.
May I hold up for one moment?
Sorry about that.
Okay. All right. So if a fraud check has been presented with your company name in the corner, you'll be notified by our accounting staff. And the only reason we notify you, there's not going to be any charge or any concern on your part. But what could happen is if it goes to a check cashing place, they might contact you and say you dishonored this check. What we will give you at that point is we'll give you an affidavit of forged endorsement that we filled out, and you can give that to the check cashing entity so they can see that you're not liable for this check. One other item I wanted to bring attention in reference to check cashing is recently we've had some employees that were not aware that the numbers on the bottom of their check, the Mickler strip, are something that they need to keep on the check. And so we've had an instance where they have been ripping off those numbers, and then the check gets presented and there's no account that they can draw that account on. The reason I bring to attention is, you know, what generally will happen at a bank at that point is they're going to say this check is not—it's not good, and that's all they'll tell the employee. And for your, you know, we want to keep your reputation intact. So, what we suggest is that, you know, new employees make sure that they're aware that that piece at the bottom of the check needs to stay there; otherwise, they're not going to be able to get their funds. Other reminders due with our year-end adjustments. There are a number of items that need to be included on your W-2s. This information should already have been conveyed to TRICOM, but I'm going to go through the, if you process your own payroll, you need to remember that these items need to be included. Group term life insurance, personal use of company auto, third-party sick pay, various costs of fringe benefits, and then a new one for this year will be the aggregate value of employer-sponsored health care for employers with more than 250 employees in 2011. Group term life. When I refer to group term life, that it's a plan that your company will have to cover your employees if it's over $50,000 of life insurance coverage. There's an imputed tax calculation that needs to be done. The cost that needs to be added to the employee's wage is based on the amount the coverage is over $50,000 and the age of the covered employee. The wage adjustment requires all taxes to be withheld. Therefore, this adjustment needs to be done on a normal payroll run, or the amounts need to be grossed up in order to include the appropriate taxes. Personal use of auto. If an employee has the privilege of using an employee-owned vehicle for personal use, there is an allocation that must be done to impute income to the employee. The wage adjustment also requires appropriate tax withholding, so you need to also do that adjustment during the payroll run. Otherwise, you need to gross that up as well. If you have a short-term disability plan for your employees, you should receive appropriate information from your carrier early in the month of January in order to properly report short-term disability income on their W-2s. If you're located in New Jersey or California, the state will release the year-end reporting, usually about the second week in January. And those reports need to be either processed by you if you're processing your payroll or forwarded to your payroll provider so those numbers can be incorporated into the employee's W-2. cost of fringe benefits, health insurance premiums paid on behalf of a 2% owner of an S corporation need to be taxed by for state and federal purposes. Some owners tax this as a distribution instead of a payroll tax adjustment. So in some cases there'll be an adjustment, in others there won't be. And new for this year is the aggregate value of employer-sponsored health care for employers with over 250 employees in 2011. The amount must be the entire cost of employer and employee contributions to health care. This amount will be included in Box 12 using the DD. The tricky piece of this is, number one, if you have a health care provider, you need to make sure that you're getting the aggregate amount, meaning what you pay and what the employee pays. This number will be in Box 12, marked DD, as I said. I think it's important that you know this information. It's just an informational box. So if your employees are asking you, what do I do with this number is not to be used during tax preparation. It is just definitely just an informative number. Year-end bonus runs. The biggest concern and why I mention year-end bonus runs is obviously if you're processing with a payroll provider, you have to give them enough time to process the year-end bonus runs. But the biggest concern relates to the special payroll runs, the timing of those payroll runs, and I get concerned about tax payments. So keep in mind that if you run bonus runs and they're not on, and you're dating it a different day than your normal payroll, just make sure that whoever does your taxes are aware of this special run so they don't miss paying that extra run of taxes. So maybe your normal check date is Friday and you run your bonus run on Tuesday. Well, if you're a weekly depositor, that's going to require you to pay two different deposits that week. So I hate for you to miss and make a late tax payment. So be sure that everybody's in the loop on when these bonus runs or year-end extra runs are being done. Year-end reports. So at the end of the year, there are a number of reports that are generated during the year-end process. Sometimes it's tricky to know what information needs to be kept, filed, and what information you need to keep readily available. Over the years, we found really two firm numbers that you need to keep with you for the future use. And really that is the number of W-2s that you process for the year and your total wages, or a lot of times they're calling that your W-3 number. We found historically that these numbers tend to be most frequently requested items, maybe if you're doing an insurance questionnaire or an RFP. Those are generally the numbers that people are looking for you. So you're going to get the stats and you're going to have your W-2s and you're going to have all this information. I would definitely keep those two pieces of information somewhere readily accessible. So in 2013, when people are asking you these questions, you have these available. If you don't wish to have paper reports and you're a TRICOM processor, please let your accounting staff know, because we can keep those, we can scan those and send them to you securely, so you don't have to keep the paper products. We can definitely send those to you electronically and then you'll have them available for future use. You know, there is a lot of volume of paper at a year end, and it's hard to know what you want to keep in paper, what you want to keep electronically. But if you have any questions on that, you can always contact the accounting staff and they'll clarify that for you as well. Year-end reports to your accountant. Most corporate tax returns are due on March 15th, 2013. Your accountant will request this information, obviously, as soon as possible in order to complete the tax returns for you by that date. If TRICOM prepares your financial statements, your accountant will gather everything that you need and either send it to your accountant, whichever you prefer. For those of you who do not have TRICOM prepare your financial statements, you'll need to get together your 2012 information for your accountant as soon as possible. TRICOM, if you're a TRICOM client, TRICOM will have your year-end sales and payroll reports available to you and your monthly analysis by the second week in January. If you're a multi-state employer, remember you'll need to provide to your accountant the sales and payroll amounts by state. If you're a TRICOM full-service employer, your accountant can gather that information for you. Now I'd like to introduce Mike Ochter to go through some of our updates for 2013.
Good afternoon. I just wanted to go over this section, which will explain some of the updates to the tax items for 2013. As you can see, the Social Security wage limit has increased from $110,100 up to $113,700. If there is no additional legislation that gets passed before the end of the year with all the fiscal cliff talks, the Social Security rate will raise from 6.2% from its current rate of 4.2%, and that is just for the employee side. The employer is still at 6.2. Additional changes as well that are in store is for the Medicare tax, and for any employee who has compensation in excess of $200,000 in a calendar year, the employer will need to withhold an additional 0.9% Medicare tax on all those wages. There is, for that additional Medicare tax, there is no additional employer match that will go along with that. There's also some 401k increases for 2013 as well. The limit has been increased from $17,000 to $17,500. And if you have any employees who are 50 years or older, their catch-up is an additional $5,500 for their 401k. As of yet, we still didn't, the transportation credits for qualified parking have yet to be determined. This next section kind of goes over a little bit on the FUTA credit reduction update. For 2012, this is the third year that states with federal loans outstanding will have a FUTA credit reduction amounts. There are 18 states and one territory that were not able to repay their loans to the federal government by November of this year. And this entire concept is a little tricky to grasp just because of being called a national credit reduction. What this means is that the current rate for federal unemployment is actually 6%. From this rate, the employers that pay their state unemployment taxes on time would receive a credit of 5.4%, which really brings down that federal unemployment rate to a 0.6% as far as what the employer is going to be responsible for. However, if you are in a state that does have these outstanding loan payments, your credit of 5.4% is reduced by some percentage depending on how long your loan has been outstanding. And if you look at the chart, it shows the states with the current reduction amounts that do apply to that current credit reduction. So instead of getting a full 5.4, this reduction will be less based on what state you may be in it and how long those loans have been outstanding. And there were some additional updates for the FUTA credit reduction this year. There were a couple states that were removed from the credit reduction because they've either have been paying the government back or requesting waivers under specific conditions. There were a couple states that were added and are new in 2012. Those were Delaware, Arizona, and Vermont. And these rates will all increase in 2013 by an additional 0.3% unless those states become current with their unemployment loans. And that is normally found out, again, by November of 2013. If you look at the current slide, there is a listing of the state and what their unemployment wage base is for 2013. If you look on this list, there are 22 states that have increased their wage limits. And there is one state, Illinois, that has decreased the wage limit for 2013. Also has several states that will have tax table changes this year. If you do have any employees that are working in the, that are working in these states, they may see a change in their state withholding for 2013. So if they do have any questions regarding that as far as why maybe their net check has changed or what it normally was, that is most likely is going to be the reason why. In addition to the tax tables that may be changing, there are also some states that are having some minimum wage increases for 2013. And if you are ever going into a new state, TRICOM's website does have a resource page for each state. And on these resource pages, it does detail the minimum wage for each state, along with some other information as well that's very helpful. For example, there are items, if, as far as going into a new state, and having questions whether or not there is an employee or employer disability that is required to be withheld, whether or not the state charges sales tax for temporary staffing, as there are a handful of states that do charge that. In addition, whether or not there are any local or county withholding taxes that you may need to be aware of and need to get registered for. This should be the first resource for your general information if you are looking into doing business in a new state. If you do have employees that are in New Jersey, there have been some employee tax rate changes. New Jersey has changed two of the four rates that make up their employee expense deductions. The employee unemployment rate, which is made up of unemployment and workforce development, has not increased. The employee disability rate increased from 0.2% to 0.36% for 2013. The family leave, or FLI tax, has increased from 0.08% to 0.1%. In total, the rate has increased from 0.705% in 2012 to 0.885% in 2013 on the first $30,900 of wages. Lastly, the California Disability has increased their wage base for employees paid disability from $95,585 to $100,880 for 2013, but the actual disability rate has not increased and will again be 1% for 2013.
Okay, now let's go through a few of the items that are new for 2013. Governor Christie in New Jersey signed into law in September of 2012 the New Jersey Equal Pay Notification Law. This law emphasizes each person's right to be free from gender inequality or bias in pay, compensation, benefits, or other terms of employment. This law has specific posting and distribution requirements. The distribution of this notice relates to employers with 50 or more employees. They're required to distribute a copy of the notice to all employees no later than 30 days after it's issued by the Department of Labor. But as of today, the notice hasn't been issued. The notice must be distributed to all new employees at the time of hiring. The notice must be distributed to existing employees annually by December 31st of each year, and the notice must be provided at any time an employee requests it. So employers may distribute the notice either by mail or by handing it out as a printed copy to the employees or via a website. But as long as the website is only meant for workers and can be accessed by all workers, and they have been notified that the notice has been posted. The notice must be accompanied by an acknowledgement to be signed by the employee, affirming that they've read and understand the notice. The notice needs to be posted in English and Spanish and any other language that the New Jersey Department of Labor makes available to the employers, in which the company believes is the first language of a significant number of their workforce. So right now, the law is in place, but it's because the Department of Labor hasn't made available the necessary posting, there's really nothing you can do at this time until they make it available. I've been checking every day. As soon as it is available, we will make sure that it's posted on TRICOM's website for your reference. Illinois has put a requirement in for additional wage reporting. It requires all employers over 250 employees to file a monthly wage report. Why are they requesting this additional reporting? Well, their goal is to reduce Medicaid and unemployment fraud by stopping it sooner. The state feels that monthly reporting of wages will notify the state sooner if anyone is working and also collecting unemployment. Employers will be required to file monthly wage reports every month of the quarter using the TaxNet product, which is what they're currently using. The reason they've chosen this 250 employee threshold is because right now at 250 employees, you're required to file your quarterly reports electronically. So the TaxNet is the product they're currently using, so they're asking you instead of reporting quarterly, you're going to report these wages monthly. So in February, you report January, and then in March, beginning of March, you report February, and then you do your normal quarterly reporting. These monthly reports require a little bit less information. They're just looking for the name, the Social Security number, and the monthly wage paid. Obviously, if you're a TRICOM employee, this reporting is going to get taken care of for you. Massachusetts Governor Patrick signed into law on August 6, 2012, a very comprehensive Massachusetts Temporary Workers' Right to Know Act. This act is very similar to acts that have been put in place in New York and California, but this act is a little bit more in-depth. It will take effect January 31st, 2013. The legislation places a lot of legal requirements on staffing agencies, substantially more than the other acts have done. There are a number of items that must be communicated to an employee prior to the end of their first pay period. Initially, this information can be conveyed to the employee over the phone, but it does need to be in writing because there is an acknowledgement. The employee must be given the name, address, and phone number of the staffing agency or the agent that's placing them, the staffing agency's workers' compensation carrier, the name and address also of the worksite employer, and the telephone number of the Department of Labor Standards. The employee must be given a description of the job, any special requirements like clothing, accessories, or tools. The employee must be notified of the designated pay day and the actual hourly rate of pay and compensation. The employee must be notified of the daily start time and the anticipated daily end time, and the duration of the assignment if that's known. The employee must be notified of any meals provided by the agency or worksite employer, and if there are any charges to that employee. The employee must also be notified if there's any transportation to the worksite and any fees that are charged to the employee for the transportation. Under the area of transportation, there are specific guidelines that need to be followed. The staffing agency that provides the transportation for their employees cannot charge more than the actual cost of the transportation, so they can't make money on the transportation. If the use of the transportation is required, then you can't charge the employee. If an agency sends an employee to a work site on a day that no work exists, they must refund the cost of the transportation to the employee. There are some other items that are required under the Act as well. The Act prohibits charging a procurement fee for employment, so you can't charge an employee to send them out to work. And you can't charge the employee for the cost of the criminal offender record request. The Act prohibits charging the applicant for any debit cards, payroll cards, money orders over the cost that is of the employer. Staffing agency may not charge the employee for any good or service unless they have a written contract that the employee understands that this purchase is voluntary and provides that the staffing company not gain a profit on any charges that they would do to the employee. The Act prohibits any costs that reduce the employee below minimum wage. Basically, as a general comment of this, it seems like that there's a lot of extensive requirements and notifications to this Act, but I think it's meant for, I think a lot of the people on this webinar are probably doing a majority of these items. I think this is more to combat the staffing companies who are not giving information, and so I don't think that this is undue burden necessarily for a lot of staffing companies, because I think this is general information that they're giving their employees. But it is extensive, and it is it seems like it's a lot when you look at it. The other items that they have is that any changes to the original terms of employment must be provided to the employee. So if you change their rate of pay or any kind of costs or charges, those must be provided to the employee, and they must have a signed acknowledgement that they've received this information. Staffing agencies are also required to display the posting of these requirements as well as the phone number of the Department of Labor Standards. The Department of Labor Standards will create a sample poster, but yet again, this isn't available. This won't be going into place until the end of January, so we're looking for a little bit more material that will be available from the state to take care of this information. The final category that we're going to talk a little bit about, which I'm sure everybody's kind of sick of hearing these words, is the fiscal cliff. We're going to talk a little bit about the payroll fiscal cliff and what that really means to us in as it relates to strictly payroll, not necessarily all the tax ramifications, but strictly the payroll check ramifications. There are two pieces to this, one being the Economic Growth and Tax Relief Reconciliation Act items from 2001 that are going to sunset on 12/31, and then the other being the economic growth, the non-economic growth provisions that will expire at the end of the year. It's very likely, as Mike spoke about before, that the Social Security rate for 2013 for employee side will increase from the 4.2 that it is right now to 6.2. I think this is going to have the biggest effect on staffing as far as employees. I mean, they're going to see a 2% decrease in their check from 1 week to the next. So I think it's going to have a huge effect, and we're going to need to, as employers, we're going to need to be ready to address and explain that. Many staffing companies also receive the Work Opportunity Credit, or the WOTC credit, for hiring qualified veterans. This credit will cease to be available for those veterans hired after 12/31. So they're not taking away the credit prior veterans, but this credit will end once the hiring point of 12/31/2012, as of right now, that credit will stop. Another major change that'll greatly affect employees' checks is the lowest tax bracket. In 2012, the lowest tax bracket is 10%. If no legislation is passed, the rate will expire and the lowest tax rate will become 15%. So again, that's a big jump. That's a 50% increase in the tax rate for our lowest tax bracket. Some of the other changes are the current tax rates of 25%, 28%, and 33%, those all increased by 3% to 28, 31, and 36. And then the current 35% tax rate will increase to 39.6. Again, that's what will happen if nothing happens. There's some marriage penalty provisions that assist in the removal of the marriage penalty for joint filers in certain wage brackets that will also expire. There will be an increase in the withholding for supplemental income from what is required now of 25% federal withholding to 28% federal withholding. There are also some other items that affect payroll, but we all know that there are a number of provisions that relate to non-payroll that are also tend to expire.
Okay, my name is Amanda Jadrow, and I'm going to talk a little bit about our educational resources that are available to our clients. As a financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it's our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series in February of 2011, designed to share expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. We look forward to continuing to bring you our Industry Insider webinar series in 2013, covering a wide range of topics specific to the staffing industry. We encourage you to continue to take advantage of this complimentary resource. In response to client requests, TRICOM launched the Tutor two-day training seminars in both sales and operations for your internal staff. The purpose of the operations seminar is to assist you in bringing new staff up to speed and have them contributing to your staffing company as soon as possible. The session covers your staffing operations' most critical topics, from customers and billing, payroll, workers' compensation, reciprocity rules, unemployment rules, social media, accounts receivable, credit and collections, and more. For the sales seminar, TRICOM partnered with a staffing sales expert, such as Tom Erb from Talent Resources, to bring your sales team to the next level. This session is designed to walk you through the entire sales process from prospecting to closing, leaving you with a complete detailed sales plan that can immediately be put into action. TRICOM will post on our website, send out emails, and overnight flyers as to the dates of the 2013 informative operations and sales seminars. If you have any questions or would like more information on either of these resources, please feel free to contact me directly.
All right, the floor is open for questions. I see one here already, so I'm going to go ahead and deliver that if you're ready. So the question that's come over here, is anyone sending a memo out to their employees to let them know that their payroll taxes will increase? So I think the question is, are any of our clients or anyone that we know of sending out kind of a proactive notification to their employees to give them a heads up?
I have not been speaking with anyone that has that, but I know that it's been discussed within offices, not necessarily the memo, but mm-hmm. people have been talking, I think, to clarify to their employees and say, you know, that this fiscal cliff you're hearing, this is what they're talking about. This is how it affects you. Yeah. It's actually a very unique idea to send out those memos. I don't know how much an employee will you know, only you can discuss how much your employees read the memos that you put inside their checks. But I think it's important that everybody's up and understanding the situation.
Very good. All right. We've got some more time here. If anyone else has any other questions, please feel free to put them into the chat feature and respond to all participants. We're happy to address any questions or any other talking points that you have.
I don't think we do. If you have any other questions after, feel free. You have our information. Just contact myself or I think Amanda's information is on there, and we can answer any questions you might have. Keep going to Tricon's website. As soon as we get any updates on this information, we will definitely post it. I know that our president tweets mm-hmm. any information that she receives. From a variety of different places, if we find out any other information on any of these points, we will definitely get that out to you.
All right. Well, I think that was pretty much the questions that we had. So I'd like to thank all of the participants today, as well as Mary Jo and Mike, for sharing their knowledge and in preparation for your end. The recording of this webinar will be available on our website, www.tricom.com/resources. If you have any questions or would like the webinar recording, feel free to contact Mary Jo, Mike, Amanda, or myself, Shelley. Thank you again for your participation and watch for information on the next webinar session. And just a reminder, the polling questions are open, and we do appreciate any feedback that you give us. We are always looking for new topics of interest that you guys would like us to cover. So thank you very much for joining us today. Have a good afternoon, everyone. I did see that there's one other question that popped up. Please go ahead and type in your question into the chat feature, and we'll wait for you to get it typed in. We will answer that here yet. Okay, well, it looks like the individual who had posed a question may have already dropped off. So we are going to go ahead and end our session. Thank you again, everyone. Have a good afternoon.